We know when the Roadshow's in for a cracking day because amidst the clamour of the crowds is an inner silence. It's our experts, like Alec here, concentrating very hard before they let loose on some fine object that's been put before them. And there were lots of those here recently when our charabang arrived in Somerset, so much so that we can welcome you to a second helping of great finds from Wells. Roadshow is all about discovery, revealing the story of antiquities that have survived through the centuries, that have touched people's lives, and sometimes tell us a little something about how we live today. And all of that applies to where we find ourselves now. Just look at this. People sit and admire the west front of the cathedral, rather like our experts scrutinise a great painting. And it's an amazing achievement, given that work was begun on it almost 800 years ago. Inside is no less impressive. Engineers today are awestruck by the brilliance of 14th century thinking. These scissor arches stabilise the whole building and prevent the collapse of the central tower. Much of it made from local limestone, quarried from the Mendips. This has to be my favourite corner, the tomb of Bishop Bitton, reputedly the most ancient engraved slab in England, and at one time thought to be a cure for toothache. According to legend, one touch, and the agony was gone, which is why it's so worn here. And in the 19th century, when they opened up the tomb, they discovered the skeleton of the bishop, perfectly preserved, and every tooth intact. There are four ancient gates which shut off the palace from the rest of the city. Odd, you might think, for a bishop's home to be built in such a defensive manner, with a moat, a portcullis, even a chute for pouring molten lead or oil on would-be attackers. But it was built during a time of real social unrest, so they weren't taking any chances. Today, the drawbridge is down as we welcome the people of Wells to the gardens of the Bishop's Palace.
Now, I can see you're holding a Bunnikin's bow. It takes me back to the 1970s when I worked for Royal Doulton. Surprisingly, I had a lot to do with Bunnikins because I was involved in their history. But tell me, why have you got the bowl?
I'm here with the bowl because I am the niece of the original artist.
Barbara Vernon Bailey.
Barbara Vernon Bailey. Ah. So I've brought along the bowl, but I've also brought along the original painting to go
with
it.
Which I have here. And this is a drawing by Barbara Vernon Bailey for that bowl.
For that bowl.
She intrigued me because, I mean, most people I think know she was a nun. And suddenly, one day, she invented this sort of series of rabbits, and her family ran the company at that point, and they put it into production, and to everybody's amazement, it took off.
Yes.
And has gone on and gone and on and gone on. And what was she like?
She was absolutely... She taught me, actually. I was at school, in her school, and she taught me. She was absolutely terrifying. One assumes because she painted little rabbits, she was, you know, gentle,
lovely,
soft,
and Beatrix
warm.
Pottery, yes.
But she was absolutely terrifying, very tall, with an enormous hook nose and an enormous chin. And she would lean over you and sort of... Very, very strict, and everyone was terrified.
And so this is very unlike her, really.
Completely. Completely alien to... Well, we all knew her as Babs.
Babs.
Completely alien to the person I know.
You see, that's what I love, because I thought, you know, I wanted to know... What an extraordinary person. Who is a nun who designs rabbit tableware? And you've answered.
Not what you expect.
I mean, to be fair, it was a very, very successful design. Early 1930s, onward and onward and onward, there are hundreds of designs. And of course, there are hundreds of collectors because there are rare designs and early versions and all that sort of collector stuff. Is this the only drawing you've got?
No, I do have one other drawing.
And again, related to a piece?
Yes. Yeah. I mean, I have about 60 pieces.
So, lovely drawing. There's the bowl. What's the drawing worth?
No idea.
They're pretty rare. I think a Bunnikins collector is going to pay £300-£500 for one with a provenance like yours.
Yeah.
You know, it couldn't be better. Straight out of the family.
Yes.
Out of the nun's lair, as you might say. Out of the convent.
I didn't steal it.
Actually, it says on the back, it says Christmas present.
Well, here's a cornerstone of Antarctic literature. The Heart of the Antarctic being the story of the British Antarctic Expedition 1907-9 by E.H. Shackleton. Here's a picture of the man himself, looking very young and very suave.
Yeah, isn't he?
Slicked back. And here, delightfully, is a Shackleton signature. And it says, to G.P. Doulette, with the author's kind regards. Now, tell me about these copies.
G.P. Doulette was the son of my great-grandfather, who was also George Doulette. He went out to Australia in 1855.
Right.
And his son, George Philip, was a bit of an entrepreneur. He had a gold mine out there, and I guess from the proceeds of that, possibly, he helped finance the second expedition.
So not this one?
Not this one.
So that's why the date is what?
1913, I believe.
1913.
Which is after the second one.
Yes. Well, I think that's absolutely splendid. This should come in three volumes, you know.
Oh, should it?
It should. The Heart of the Antarctic, two volumes, and then a volume called The Antarctic Book. And it is signed by all the members of the crew.
Right.
So tell me what you thought you have done with them.
Well, I can vaguely recall back in the early 40s, these being in the house, I found a book with these signatures in it, and I thought they may be worth something, being a schoolboy, so I can recall tearing the signature strip out with all these dozen or so.
That's appalling!
And probably exchange them for some marbles or something.
Oh, yes, as you would.
As you would.
It would have the members of the crew and the officers and all people like that on it.
Right.
And it was in two parts, on one side with the members of the British crew.
Yes.
And then on the other part, which was also stuck in, was the two members of the Australian crew.
Oh, right.
And obviously that piece of paper was sent off to Australia. They signed it.
To get the signatures.
To get the two signatures.
Right.
And the English people did it on that one. That book that I conjecture, that you don't remember, that with all the signatures in, that you threw away, would be worth £5,000 today.
Oh, my goodness.
And it would have made this set, three volumes, worth between £15,000 and £20,000.
Oh, good heavens.
I'm terribly sorry to tell you that your two volumes...
are not worth anything.
..have a Shackleton signature in, but are worth somewhere between £3,000 and £5,000.
£3,000 and £5,000?
Yes.
Oh, my goodness.
You'd probably think I was terribly rich if I told you I had nine houses.
Yes, but...
Well, I'd be lying, because I've got nine dolls' houses.
Where did you find room for them?
Well, I kind of just keep scrunching things up, as
yes,
I say.
Yes, I think you have.
Move everything closer together. But not as nice as yours. Where did you get it?
Well, to be honest, I got it from a closing down sale in Clifton, in Bristol. And she didn't want to sell it because it was hers.
Was this an antique shop?
No, it was a doll's house shop. We finally persuaded her, but we didn't have money left to go on holiday that year.
Oh, so this was your holiday?
This was our holiday.
We do share the passion, and if you were prepared to make that sacrifice.
I bought the doll's house because my doll's house, which I had when I was a child in the 30s, had to be burnt because it got woodworm.
Oh.
But they saved the contents for me, my parents, where it was stored. And most of this dates from the 30s and 40s and early 50s. But we have acquired a few more things since. I mean, we guess because it looks rather like the Czechoslovakian glass, you know, with all the sort of gingerbread work. It might be Middle European or something.
It is very unusual, isn't it?
Or from, you know, like the houses around Hamelin. In Germany, it might be German, but I don't know.
Well, it's got these wonderful multicoloured glazed panels in the roof, which allow the light on a glorious day like this to flood through into the rooms.
Yes.
But I'm afraid I think it's probably not European.
Oh.
Because it reminds me of a kind of Victorian suburban villa. It's not a house that was made commercially by a factory.
Oh,
it was made by a father or a loving uncle. And it's a bit idiosyncratic. but it does have these wonderful Victorian features. If you can imagine sort of Crystal Palace or Sydenham or Forest Hill in South London,
yes.
Lovely big suburban villas in wide tree-lined avenues.
Yes, quite...
I think we're looking at the sort of 1880s as a date here.
We're sharing the same taste then, weren't
yes,
we?
Yes, absolutely. Mm. And I think the, you know, the Germanic appearance is perhaps sort of coincidental. Now, obviously, it's difficult to show the interior because access is difficult, isn't it?
Well, you've just got these little windows opening in the roof,
one side, yes.
And then at the back, there's just one at the back, top and bottom, and that's all.
And we've pulled out a few pieces here. Are these pieces that came from your own doll's house?
Well, some of them, yes.
Which ones were those?
The fire.
Fire screen there.
And
these charming companion sets.
Companion sets.
That even have little...
Bristles
on the brushes.
I think I've jolly good to keep them, frankly.
You've done very well. And what about these two lovely Art Nouveau ladies?
They're two lovely Art Nouveau ladies, which I seized upon when I found them amongst my aunt's things.
Oh, I thought they might be earlier.
Much earlier.
I think these are about 1900, and they were made in Germany, and they're actually supposed to represent an actress or music hall artist called Laurie Fuller.
Good gracious.
And they're quite scarce. So you paid a lot of money for it when you denied yourself 2 weeks in the sun.
Well, we were trying to work out exactly how much we spent on it, and we think it was somewhere between £1,200 and £1,700.
£1,200 and £1,700. Empty. Well, I mean, there are two values, the house on its own and the house with your furnishings put in.
Yes.
But the house on its own would make £2,500 in an auction.
Really?
It's got such appeal.
It seems to have a lot of appeal by the interest it's created today.
Well, just here today, I mean, people have been admiring it. It is a glorious thing.
I had not realised at all.
And the contents are not without value, perhaps £300 or £400 for the silver pieces.
Wow, yes.
These figures of Laurie Fuller are worth £60 to £80 each.
That's amazing.
And then the house is full of other things.
Yes, yes.
So that all tops up, and I we could be looking at £3,500, maybe £4,000 for it all complete. Yes. It's lovely.
That's shattering.
Well, this is our Arga chair. The Arga's the warmest place in the house, obviously, in a rather old kitchen. And this is the chair that I sit in. We've no idea where the chair came from. We found it in the local sale rooms about 20 years ago. About £100, I remember, we paid for it. We'd been curious, but I just haven't any idea at all where it came from.
So what caught your eye when you saw it in the sale room?
It was the mixture of the arms there and then that, to me, extraordinary sort of biscuit barrel, or whatever you call it, work at the back. And the seat, I presume, is a later addition. And the squirrely wigs, I don't know why it's sort of whitish, whether it was lime or what it was. Is it oak? I don't know what it is.
Let's start at the base, shall we? Because the base is walnut. And walnut was a wood of the late 17th century and is practically always seen in its ordinary, shiny form. But somewhere along the line, this has had a gesso base and it's been sort of painted this white, which in turn has worn it away, which is, of course, what absolutely caught my eye because I love it. It's got this absolutely old feel, together with a sort of very modern feel about it, and it just would work in any. It would work in a panelled room, and it would work by the Arga, but it would work also in a sitting room. So what have we got? We've got a chair that I think was probably made, let's say, around 1700. Have you noticed its back is slightly at an angle?
Indeed, indeed, and that's what makes it so comfortable.
Absolutely. But if we saw that in a modern chair, you'd think it was going to tip over backwards, wouldn't you?
Yes.
So it's got this raked back, and as you quite rightly said, this lovely spindle turning. Now, if you think about the very early chairs, they just had a solid panel back. And when the machinery became more sophisticated, they were able to do this lovely spindle turning, the turning on the legs, which was a sort of augmentation of design, if you like, and they are absolutely stunning, aren't they? They're so simple but really, really elegant. And then you've got the spreading arms, and the spreading arms there again make it more comfortable. And what I like to fancy is, you know, you've got to think of what the chaps were wearing in those days. You know, those coats with the slightly open sides, nice wide seat, very comfortable, and currently upholstered in an old Baluch carpet.
Is it? And do you think it's English in origin? We didn't know what nationality
English,
it was.
English, transitional around 1700, and I absolutely love it. I think that I would happily pay between 1,000 and 1,500.
Well, I never. Extraordinary. Thank you very much.
So, we've got rather a lot riding on this question, and the question is this an original drawing by Renoir?
It came into the family through an uncle who was a dealer, really, with a very, very good eye.
The good eye?
A very good eye.
Did he have very good pictures?
Yes, he did.
He did have good pictures. He also had a lot of glass and china, which went to the Ashmolean, and he had quite a lot that went to Bristol City Museum. So his name was Jimmy Bomford.
Oh, I see.
And a lot of modern things, too, which was interesting. Bacon, for example.
Bacon?
Mm.
So he had a roving eye, you might say.
A very, very roving eye, absolutely.
But very, very high quality.
Very high
quality. Most of his collection is now in museums. Well, then we've got to take this object very seriously indeed. Actually, the first thing to say about it is, with the frame and everything, what a pretty thing it is.
It is a pretty thing. It's been on our, since Sarah and I can remember, forever.
And your just sisters, been part of, you?
Yes, we are.
I see.
And it's just been part of the fabric of wherever we've lived.
But you've never asked the question, is it a print or a drawing?
We've just always been led to believe it's a print, so we've never really queried it.
Right, OK. Well, we've got to find out, because if it's an original drawing, it's worth, you know, well into five figures, and who knows where you stop after that. It's incredibly convincing as a drawing. This is the thing, isn't it? Well, there are ways of telling, but I'm afraid all of them involved really taking it out of the frame. So we've got to start with that. Now, put the frame down here. And then the first thing we can see is that it's on quite a thin sheet of paper. And if we look there, there's a sort of blind stamp there.
Yes.
Now, the question is that a collector's mark or is it a publisher's mark?
What do you mean by a blind stamp?
A blind stamp is when it's embossed and it's actually pushed into the paper, rather than a stamp where it's been inked and then stamped onto the paper. And actually, usually, when they're blind stamped, I have to say, it's usually a publisher's thing, when they're pushed through the paper. So that's the first clue. You could have told that, of course, without taking it out of the frame. But the next thing we do is that we've got to look at it in a raking light, at a very, very slanting light. And luckily, we've got some nice sun, which is English September. So we're going to use that. And if you hold it up to a very raking light so that you catch the very surface texture of the paper and the marks on it, what you're looking for is a change in the sheen that you can see. There should be a mattness where the crayon is. The next thing I would do with this drawing is actually hold it up to the light again. But this time what we're looking to do is to look through the paper rather than on the paper. Yeah. And when you hold it up, you can actually see that it's on laid paper, which means that there's a wire mesh that they've dropped the wet paper onto and lifted it out of the water. And it leaves the wire marks as a slightly thinner area in the paper. That's actually quite a good sign, because if it was on a woven paper that's not made that way, it wouldn't have those wire marks, and a lot of prints were. However, put it flat down again, look at the drawing, and you'll see that the crayon has picked up lines from the laid paper that it was drawn on. You can actually see them very faintly along here.
Yeah.
And if we lift it up to the light again, you can see that those lines do not correspond with the laid paper lines of this paper. Do you see?
Yes, very clearly.
So we need to catch that line there, which is actually the line of the drawing, and then compare it to this line here, which is the line of the paper. And the same here, and the same here. I'm afraid it's a clincher. It's a print. There's no way around that. I'm really, really sorry.
It would have been just too amazing for it to have been anything else. We've never thought that it was anything else.
No, we didn't.
But it was it's great to have asked the question.
But as a decorative object in that frame, I think it's absolutely lovely.
And its provenance is special to us.
And its provenance is very good.
Yes.
A couple of hundred pounds is about the most I could really put on it.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.
This sword was given to my grandfather, Thomas Atkins, timber merchant of Northampton Wharf, Regent's Park, Northwest, by a manservant of Lord Nelson's, who was friendly with my grandfather, and he gave it for some services in connection of wood supplied for the funeral of Lord Nelson. And it's signed Rosa J. Atkins.
That's great, isn't it?
My grandfather, his mother, used to clean for Miss Atkins, and she took a liking to him and decided, because she had no children, she would pass the sword on to my grandfather. So it's been in my family for 3 generations.
Right. As it refers to wood in connection with the funeral of Lord Nelson, it might be just the coffin that Nelson was transferred into at the time. Who knows?
Yes.
It's one of those things lost to history.
Yes, yes.
And when one takes the sword out of its scabbard, look at that. A mercuric gilded blade. Now, this, of course, is illegal today. You mustn't do any mercuric gilding. So many young apprentices were killed through the fumes getting into their lungs when the blades were taken out of the vats, that they made it illegal. There were more fatalities in the cutlery trade than any other trade in London at the time. But to see this in this condition, it is truly, truly wonderful. It's a sword that would be carried by a naval officer, of course, and the date of manufacture would be around about 1800. Very well-known London maker. And of course, the grips are ivory.
Mm-hmm.
I noticed that they've got the Hanoverian coat of arms on the blade.
Would it have been a dress sword?
No, it's a fighting sword. A lot of people think that because blades are blued and gilt, they're purely for show. They're not.
Right.
This is a fighting sword. I would value this sword at somewhere between £6,000 and £8,000.
Crumbs.
Well, we're seeing two family miniatures here in the lovely autumn sunlight. Tell me all about them.
Well, the first one that you've got is a miniature portrait of Lord Robert Carr, who was the second son of the third Marquess.
Mm-hmm.
And he was killed at the Battle of Culloden.
Mm-hmm.
So this is a memorial bracelet, really. But the Carrs, in fact, sided with the Hanoverians, which was, from a Scottish point of view, was rather not so good, really.
No.
And defeated Bonnie Prince Charlie in 1746.
Extraordinary, isn't it? And I think people remember it as one of the bloodiest confrontations in the United Kingdom. It was hideous, wasn't it?
A horrendous slaughter, really.
Yes.
And he was one of the few Hanoverians who actually was killed by the Highlanders.
Mm. The Duke of Cumberland was commander-in-chief and had that curious accolade of being called Butcher Cumberland on account of the way that he pursued the Scots and murdered them.
He pursued the Scots, and this man's brother and father went with Cumberland and did the dirty work, as it were.
My goodness, what a terrifying story. The funny thing is that it certainly is an 18th century miniature, but the bracelet is 19th century.
Oh,
and what's interesting from my point of view is that it's been cut down to be accommodated into this bracelet. His head is too far up in the sort of composition.
Well, I think it was owned by my ancestor, who was his great nephew, Lord Mark Carr, who was a sailor, and he was very strongly establishment.
Yes, and
he liked the association with the fact that he had been killed at the Battle of Culloden, and he was showing his loyalty to the crown.
My goodness. Well, I mean, that's certainly evident from
that. Would have been worn by his wife.
Yes, definitely. And I suppose there was a great sort of antiquarian interest in one's sort of ancestors, really. And that's probably how that happens, because the bracelet, in my view, is about 1840, and certainly not an 18th century one. And so from that point of view, it's very interesting. But your family goes on with yet more fascinating connections in the form of this one, doesn't it? Tell me about that.
That was given to my great-grandmother, and she had been Queen Victoria's Lady of the Bedchamber and Lady in Waiting,
and clearly it is a memento of great affection, isn't it? And it says just that. It says for Countess Antrim, from her affectionate Victoria R.I. Queen and Empress. It means 1891, and it's 30 years after Albert's death. She was 30 years a widow, wasn't she? I mean, well, she was 40 years a widow, but this is her 30th year.
Yeah.
And curious enough, it's interesting that she chooses opals, because Prince Albert's favourite stone was the opal. He was very fascinated fascinated in the refracted light that it makes.
Yes.
And by this time, she was Empress of India and presided over two-thirds of the world's surface and three-quarters of its population. So I think if you had a bracelet from her, it was rather a good thing to have. My goodness, I bet there was a very, very deep curtsy when she received that, don't you think?
I think so,
be able to get up again. Marvellous.
One of the things she did was my great-grandmother, was she was quite a tall woman.
Mm-hmm.
And she used, when Queen Victoria went into Hyde Park, she used to run alongside the carriage.
My goodness, a sort of marathon lady in waiting.
She did a bit of jogging.
Well, that's how she'd stay jolly thin. It's evident she was thin, because she's got a tiny wrist.
Yes.
And aren't they marvellous things? Well, that's what jewellery is all about, really, and family connections. This one here has got great historical interest, maybe £600-700 for that. I think something really quite different for this. This has enormous appeal, in a way. It has to be £4,000-5,000, and... in a way, that's only a fraction of what it means to you and to me. So.
Absolutely, yes. I mean, one doesn't think of value in these sort of objects.
No, so. One doesn't. And I'm really thrilled with them. Thanks so much. Brilliant.
That's
wonderful.
All.
Lady Bowman, you've got a fascinating story to tell about your time in the run-up to the Second World War and during the war. You started off as a debutante in the run-up to the war, didn't you? In fact, we've got a picture of you here. Tell me about this.
Well, yes, well, I had it. By the way, do call me Christian.
Christian, I will, thank you.
We had a lovely time. We had a wonderful summer, which was nothing but sort of dances and champagne and music, and it was gorgeous. And suddenly, just like that, down came the war. And literally within, just over weeks, I was in the absolutely horrible factory.
Tell me about how that came about, because you decided that the life of a debutante was not for you, and you wanted to go into work in a factory making rivets for Halifax bombers. Why did you decide to do that?
All the chaps in my family were in the army, and one of my brothers was at home on leave, and I said, what shall I do? And he said, with a certain wisdom beyond his years, he said, this war is going to need aeroplanes. Why don't you see if you can get a job in an aeroplane factory? And then we both looked at each other. I didn't know how to do it. And so he looked in the London telephone directory, and the first entry he came to that he knew the name of was the name of the Hanley Page, they were called, who made these bombers. And so I rang up and asked to speak to the staff manager, who was a bit surprised. But anyway, within a week, I had a job there.
And your job was doing what?
Well, this is three little bits of metal, and they used to come to me in little sort of jagged shapes, just stamped out. And I had to bend them into the right shape and drill them with these little holes. The reason I have this one is that I made that hole crooked, so it wasn't any good in a plane.
Of course, no, because it would have to be absolutely precise for a plane. Oh, yes, I can see it's gone in at an angle.
I don't know what you call them. I do know, though, that they went into the leading edge of Halifax bombers. All along there.
Have you met any of the people who flew the planes for which you made these...
Yes.
These key, small but essential bits of metal?
After the Times published my letter saying, please, I want to meet somebody who flew Halifaxes, one came through the letterbox eventually from a squadron leader saying, would I go and join them at their reunion? And I was absolutely thrilled. And so I went, and they were absolutely so nice to me. And every single one of these people are heroes. They are all brave, brave men who flew these planes night after night after night. I mean, some of them had done over 50 sorties, being shot at, and, you know.
And therefore, I mean, look, this is someone from the Royal Canadian Air Force.
Yes,
here.
Well, all sorts of nationalities, and including Swedish, rather strangely.
DFC here, so
lots
recognised, yes, with a medal.
And I'm just so glad that there's still this. Some sadly are not, of course, but this lot, they're here and they're having a good time, I hope.
Well,
we certainly did.
We certainly had a good time hearing your story. Thank you so much.
It's a tiny cupboard. Look, I can put my hand on it like that, as you can. But small though it is absolutely stuffed full of something that, in a way, we'll never see. Yes. It won't fall out. It's social history. So let's show. There. And it's clearly a 20th century key cupboard.
Yes.
And you fell in love with it. Why? You like keys? What was the thing?
Nothing to do with keys. I found this in an antique shop in West London.
Right.
I walked into the shop. It was on the wall. The door was closed. I opened the door and realised what it was.
Yeah.
And one of the first key fobs I read is down here, which is Miss Naomi McGaw's jewel case. And I just was enchanted.
Yeah, right. Did you know anything about the family when you bought it?
Never heard of them.
Right.
Not at all.
And how did you track it down?
Well, some of the keys have the name McGaw on them.
Right.
And really, I wanted to find where the key case came from, because it obviously belongs to a house.
Sure.
And I went on the internet and I did some research. And I actually found out that the McGaws lived in Horsham in West Sussex.
And the house?
The house is called Forest Grange.
And does it still exist?
It does still exist.
That's remarkable, yeah. Isn't it? Let's have a look at the object itself. Here we have the wireless cabinet, two wireless cabinets. So they were obviously very advanced technically. They had Daimlers. They even mentioned the make of car. And so on. Then they had a cricket pitch as well, didn't they? Where did
yes.
I see the cricket pitch?
There,
there's the cricket field.
Yeah.
And in the pavilion, they had a dining room with its own lot. So they were obviously very wealthy. If we look here, we see this colour-coded chart. Now, Brahma keys were actually very advanced in their time.
Right.
They were invented in the late 18th century, in fact, although this is obviously much later.
Right.
And so you could, with one key, you could open every single lock in the house. Here's the master key.
Oh, right.
And so other persons, their key would only open certain locks relevant to their job in the house.
Oh, right, right.
And so we can look down here, and here we have Mr. McGaw, the owner of the house, and his key, number one, it fits everything all the way down. Should he want to, he could go into everything. And the gardener here, with key number three, and he can open far fewer locks. Look, absolutely blank. And I suspect we won't get any colour until we get to outside things.
Yes.
And here we have it all laid out in front of us. There's the occupations, there's the keys that they had access, there's the cupboards, the rooms, the stores that they had access to. And the tragedy is, of course, the tragedy is that, you know, not long after this was made, so many of the male staff of this house were killed.
Mm-hmm.
They would have joined up and they would have gone to the trenches, and how many of them came back. In a way, this is sort of evocative of the last throes of the Edwardian grand country house.
Absolutely.
That simply wasn't going to reappear after the war. You loved it.
Absolutely, yes.
And you paid...
£300.
How long ago?
10 years ago.
That, to me, is an indication of how much you loved it.
I did. I fell in love with that.
But I think it's gone up a little bit, but in real terms, not a great deal. Let's say £500 in round figures.
That surprises me.
I
wouldn't matter if it hadn't increased a penny.
Well, I think it's likely
it's not the money, like you say.
What do you think it is?
Well, I thought it was a lamp, but that's all I know, really. I only saw it for the first time last night.
So it's not yours?
No, it belongs to my sister. She was given it as a present.
Yeah.
By her husband. They just got married, and she's very fond of it.
And does it stay by her bedside and have a little flame in it?
It's in her bedroom, but I don't
know. It is it right?
Hope okay. The flame's there.
Now, okay, well, it's certainly not a teapot, because teapot like that would not pour very well. And because the spark goes straight up, which is, you know, no good to anybody.
No.
However, is it a lamp? Well, it has a sort of Aladdin-y look about it, doesn't it?
Mm-hmm.
I remember my old Danish grandmother, when there'd been a smoking party at home with all the gentlemen of my grandfather's acquaintance, she produced little pastilles in the room, which she burnt on a wick. And I think that that's what this is for. You put some sort of fragrant oil in here to scent the room after a party. And that, of course...
Stopper?
Well, it's a snuffer.
Oh, right.
It's just for snuffing out flame.
Right.
But another thing it could be, it could be the reverse of that. It could be a little vessel actually for lighting cigars. At the end of a meal, a gentleman would have the cigars passed round, and there would be a lamp, sometimes permanently lit, which was passed around the table for you to light your cigar with. OK, well, it's one of those two things, in my view. No Japanese mark on the bottom there. In fact, it says Gorham Co. This has all the marks of the aesthetic movement. And the name Gorham is second only to another American name, Tiffany. Wow. And Tiffany was a big arts and crafts concern as well. America was becoming incredibly wealthy at this time, and they wanted to be right at the spearhead of aestheticism. So a little bronze object manufactured in the Oriental style, either for lighting cigars or for infusing the room afterwards. Well, go home and tell your sister it's probably worth to an American collector these days, who can tell, somewhere in the region of £1,000 or £2,000.
Wow.
So we can rub it a little.
Yeah. Wow.
Now, it's the era before the movies, it's before the television, it's before everything that we take as entertainment today, and yet there were interesting moving images around, this being one of them.
Yes.
And it was all down to a device called a magic lantern.
That's right.
And these are some of the slides that went with the magic lantern.
Yes.
Now, tell me a little bit about what we have here. I noticed on this particular slide there were some initials. Here we go. WMS.
That's my grandfather's name, William Martin Smith.
And what was his profession?
He was a public wharfinger. Nobody knows what a public wharfinger is.
Is it something that you get locked up for?
It's public warehouse keeping, but on the banks of the River Thames, he had one of those big warehouses the barges came up to.
So that was his day job, but in the evening he was he something else?
Yes, he was closely involved with his church, and so this was part of the entertainment and education of the children.
There were dozens of companies producing magic lanterns, the devices themselves.
Yes.
And, of course, then the slides to go with them.
Yes.
Now, the slides came in various types, didn't they? I mean, I perhaps picked one of the more interesting ones, but some of the less exciting, perhaps, more prosaic, are ones that don't move. Things like this, which are panoramas of different things going on. It looks like all sorts of hijinks.
Sort of Guy Fawkes night.
It certainly looks as if there's some sort of party going on there.
Yes. There's another one that shows Queen Victoria's procession to the House of Lords.
Ah, and there she is, the Queen going to the House of Lords. Fabulous.
Yes, now, all hand-painted.
Have you ever seen a magic lantern show itself?
Well, yes, we've got a magic lantern at home, and my father used to show these slides.
Oh, fantastic. Well, now, this one I rather like. This
is showing the curvature of the Earth. Yes.
Showing the curvature of the Earth. This is a lever-operated slide where there's a man standing on the top of the world there, just as we feel today, all of us, on top of the world, don't we? So there they are, on top of the world, and you can see the ship disappearing over the horizon line. And then if I switch the lever back the other way, up it comes. First of all, you see the masts, a bit more of the masts, the sails, and then you see the whole ship as it comes up over the surface of the Earth. Fabulous object. The most valuable individual slide is going to be the chromatrope slide.
Yes.
And this particular one is going to be worth about £150.
Ooh.
Which is good news.
Yes.
So if we're adding it all together, I would have thought we're getting on for perhaps, well, between 800 perhaps and £1,000 on a good day.
I'm very pleased I came.
I'm delighted. And let's just finish. We'll send everybody into psychedelia land by finishing on this one. Off you go.
Oh, it's such a perfect day. I'm glad I spent it with you. Oh, such a perfect day. You just keep me hanging on. You just keep me hanging on.
Delightful box. But what's his history? Well, it's got a fairly short history for me. I actually bought it about a year ago in a local antique shop. And it was sold to me really as an 18th century sugar casket.
So are you actually a collector of silver or collecting broadly?
Not particularly silver, but I have had a long interest, probably about 50 years, in antique furniture mainly. Mm-hmm. But I just fell in love with this, so I thought, well, OK, let's go for it.
To be precise, we've actually got the date letter there for 1744.
Right.
So we are literally in the middle of the century, in the reign of George II. Did they give you a maker?
No.
I love the name of this maker. It sounds so sort of Dickensian. Francis Crump. So it's made by Mr. Crump.
Right.
But it is the most delightful piece of Rococo work. Beautifully executed flower heads here. And then with the lion, lovely expression on his face, and the way his tail is just tucked round his leg. Lovely little feature. What did you pay for it?
Well, I've now got to confess, because I actually gave £600 for it, but my wife didn't actually know that until today.
Right. So what's your wife's reaction to £600?
She wasn't very pleased initially. She thought that was rather a lot of money to spend on a box, and not sure that she's too keen on it. But I just fell in love with it, and I thought, well, it looks a great box.
Do you know that's the best way to buy anything, because you fall in love with it? Then what does it matter, actually?
Well, I fell in love with her once, so I thought, well, you know.
Well, same principle. But today, it's quite a rare box, actually.
Right.
You don't get many sugar boxes from the mid-18th century, mm-hmm. So I would not be surprised to see that selling at auction for perhaps £1,500, £2,000.
Perhaps I can tell her that.
Tell her.
It's all right, you forgot.
Wow. I didn't think it would be worth anywhere near that.
I use it to keep all my bills and my envelopes and my writing stuff down here. And actually, I just found something at the back that I didn't know was there. And above, I use it as a china display cabinet.
Well, it seems to me that that's what it was made for, a display cabinet. It's a very feminine piece of furniture, It's absolutely tremendous. It's got slightly odd proportions, I have to say. It's a very tall piece of furniture. The cornice in particular is a bit on the narrow side, but the eye is taken by the painting across the frieze, which is lovely. Then you've got these Corinthian capitals, which stick out very prominently on top of the reeded columns, which come down the side in a very architectural way. Which lead the eye down past all the wonderful ceramics or whatever one's got in there to this extraordinary, it should be a cylinder top, but it's kind of flattened cylinder top. It's kind of a mixture between a cylinder and a flat-fronted secretaire or a full-front secretaire, and then on down into what becomes a pedestal desk. So you've got storage, the sort of business end and the display end. But this has got to have been made for a woman, don't you think?
Yes, definitely. I was thinking maybe Lady Hamilton or something like that.
Well, absolutely. Mm-hmm. An original to the early 19th century, yes. I think. Exactly at the period you were saying, Lady Hamilton. Yes. So let's just have a quick look inside. And I think you might need to help me with this. Oh, it goes back very easily, doesn't it? So there we've got drawers, pigeonholes, as you'd expect. And it might look a little bit low, but in fact this slides out so you can get your knees underneath it. Here, a little reading slide. So everything for the blue stocking, in a way. So I think it's an absolutely splendid piece. So, you know, where could it have been made? Ireland, perhaps. Or one of the centres out of London. York was a great centre. Bristol, even, was a great centre of furniture making. But I don't think you're ever going to know for sure.
Really?
Now, is this a family piece, or how did you come to get it?
Well, my grandmother acquired it during the Second World War from an antique dealer in Andover, and she got a lot of stuff from him, and I think she got it at very reasonable prices.
I think now you'd be looking at about £5,000 if you were to try and sell it.
Yes.
So it's such a decorative piece.
I really love it.
And Lady Hamilton, I think,
so
stays in the mind.
The
Why did you bring me a toast rack?
I don't know. I was going out the door and think, what should I take? And it was there, and I thought, well, I'll take it. Never dreaming that you would actually think enough of it to
I think it's wonderful. Show it. What do you think it is?
Well, at first, when I first saw it in a charity shop on a shelf, I thought it was 1970s. Mm-hmm. Because in the 70s or 80s, we had a sort of revival of this brown, didn't
we? Yeah, we did.
And then when I reached up and put it down, I thought, no, it is different. It reminded me of, like, the Dalton Harvest jugs. Mm-hmm. So I looked for a Dalton mark, but there isn't one.
There's no
mark.
So
I was disappointed. But it was £6.
You're halfway there. You said Dalton. It's not Dalton, but it is salt glazed stoneware.
Ah, salt. Ah.
So where else was salt glazed stoneware made? It was made in Derby. It was made in Bristol. It was made in Nottingham. I'm going to go for Nottingham. Mm. That sort of soft colour that you get in the Nottingham ones. Dalton is often much darker, but it's the same material.
Okay.
I think this is about 1840s, 1850s.
Wow.
And it's so rare because I've discussed it with one or two of my colleagues. None of us have ever seen a salt glazed stoneware toast rack. The decoration is Rococo Revival, which is exactly that period, but all these things are wonky.
Yes, you know,
and I can see them thinking, oh, let's make toast racks. They have toast these days. They had a go and they thought, oh, not very good. It doesn't work very well, does it?
Right.
Give it up. Don't bother with toast racks. Uh-huh. Go on making the jars and the pots that they're good at. And so I think there were very, very few salt glazed stoneware toast racks. And it is immaculate.
I know, I couldn't believe it myself.
So, £6 in a charity shop. Hmm. Well, I think this is a very expensive toast rack. I think they're going to say £250.
Wow. Yes, a lot of money.
It's a lot of money for a toast rack, but it's not a lot for a very, very rare salt glazed stoneware one.
Fantastic.
Great object.
This is a spectacular group of late 18th, early 19th century miniatures, all pastels, and they're absolutely wonderful, especially with these frames and these lovely swags here. Now, are they your family?
They're my mother's family, who lived at the manor house in Frenchay, the Tanner family.
Yes.
And they've just always been passed down to my mother, her mother, and down the family.
And do you know all the names of the sitters on here?
No.
This one on the right here, the elder lady, I think I'd be rather worried if she was my mother-in-law.
Yes.
She's terrifying.
I quite agree, yes.
And then the ones down here, which are absolutely charming, these beautifully observed pastels. Look at that.
Yeah.
We come to the name of the artist, and I see on the back one it's got James Sharples.
Yes.
Which is very, very interesting because, you know, in the late 18th century and early 19th century, if you wanted to be painted, you'd go, you know, to a really good portrait painter. And, of course, the portrait painters went where the money was.
Right.
Now, he was an interesting man, born in Lancashire, and was supposed to be a pupil of Romney's, but came down to work in Bath, and he also worked in New York and Philadelphia, which is really interesting for a pastel portrait painter.
Yes, at that time.
Yeah. And I would have think, you know, these would have been painted, or would have thought that these would have been painted in the sort of Bath area. And he came down to Bath in the early 1800s. And these looked to have been painted sort of 1800, 1805, that sort of date. Would that tie in with what you know?
Yes. And on the back of one of them, that from my grandfather wrote notes on the back, and he's around circa 1800.
So is this how you hang them at home?
No, there are some swags that join them all together. I've got a picture here.
God, they're wonderful. I love this. It's like something out of a Wedgwood pattern, isn't it? All those swags there.
Definitely, yes.
And what adds value to these, which I think is so interesting, is that James Staples worked in America and in England.
Yes.
And because he worked in America and England, would add value because the American connection.
Yes. Oh, right.
So we then come to putting a value on them. And I think, as I said, if it had been a normal English artist, I would have said £400 to £600, £500 to £700. I think this is worth certainly £1,000 to £1,500.
Right.
I think this one's worth £1,000 to £1,500, even though she's quite fearsome. It's beautifully done.
Yeah.
These are worth £1,000. I think some of the lesser ones are like this down here, which is slightly rubbed, because pastel can be rubbed quite easily.
And
worth probably sort of 600 to 800. So it mounts up. You know, you've got 1, 2, 3, 4. You've got about £6,000 worth there.
Yeah, thank you.
Okay.
Thank you very much.
Am I not a man and a brother? And there's the figure of a kneeling slave. British and Foreign Anti-Slavery Society. What an interesting object that is.
Very interesting, isn't it?
How did it come to you?
In 1960, my mother bought a table from a friend of a friend who was moving into an old people's home, and she paid £5 for the table, which was a Victorian card table. Beautiful table, she's still got it. That was in the drawer.
So it was a complete
surprise that it was there.
Yeah.
And it's basically been in a drawer for the last 50 years. That's carnelian, I believe.
Yeah, carnelian, just like my ring, which is also a cameo.
Mm. And I presume that's silver.
I think that
or maybe pewter.
I think it's steel.
Steel, really?
This is a seal, and you would need something really, really strong. So lignum vitae or maybe rosewood with the steel cuff and then this lovely carnelian. It's a beautiful thing, and let's see whether it works. Now, I'm going to push really hard, and let's keep our fingers crossed that it doesn't hang on. Well, it's better than nothing, isn't it? Actually, it shows you just how finely carved that is. Imagine carving, thinking backwards to carve that relief and getting all the muscles and the detail, the perspective of the figure is some tribute. Now, this is an image I recognise from my ceramics background. In 1787, Josiah Wedgwood, who was a prominent member of the Anti-Slavery Society,
right,
commissioned one of his artists, and we think it was William Hackwood, a very, very talented carver of cameos, to create a special medallion which shows a kneeling slave.
And that's with, the same.
With more or less in this position. He's actually shown in profile in the original cameo. A year later, we know that Josiah Wedgwood sent over to Benjamin Franklin a whole consignment of these anti-slavery medallions.
Oh.
And because it was such a popular cause amongst many people in the States, these medallions were worn as badges, well, rather like, you know, modern political badge.
Yes.
But as we know, they didn't succeed in getting slavery abolished until, what, 1833?
Yes.
Which is a whole 50-something years later.
I sort of guessed it was prior to 1830.
Yeah.
Sorry, but...
Now, this would have belonged... Gosh, it would be really nice to know who owned that piece of furniture. This would have been a very, very prominent member, I think, of the Anti-Slavery Society. This is an incredibly poignant piece of social history. And for that reason, it's going to be worth a lot more than your average cameo. I'm going to say it's worth somewhere in the region of, well, let's say, £1,500 to £2,000.
Really?
Better than a wad of notes, though, isn't it?
Certainly is. And, well, the value is meaningless, really, because it will just go back in the drawer.
What we've got here, unusually, is face down. And it's a mirror. And what I want to know is, weren't you dying to get it out of its box and see what was going on at the back? I mean, how long have you had it in the family for?
All my life.
Yeah.
You've known it all
and your life. And my father's as well.
Yes.
So it's been in the family for a long time.
A long time, and it's been in this case.
So very carefully with my colleagues, we've taken off the, the wooden back and... Well, first of all, we've come across some brown paper with the name Roberts. Does that mean anything to you?
Yes.
Roberts of Rotherham.
That's it.
Right.
And that's your maiden name.
My maiden name.
So that shows...
I've never seen that before.
Okay,
of course
so
I haven't.
Mr. Roberts of Warren House, Rotherham, that's was your father. So let's just take this away.
Okay.
Yeah.
I'll put the paper over here.
Oh, my goodness me. Look at that. Is that green beige? Gosh.
How fabulous is that?
Wow.
Look at this original colour to this lovely, lovely...
That's absolutely astonishing.
Italian, best quality velvet.
Is it?
Yeah.
So this is the back of the mirror, but what's really interesting is, do you see how you've got this line where the colour is different?
Oh, I know what, yes.
And so this was the support for the mirror.
Oh,
it's
and a it stand, was, isn't it?
It must have been mirror. Freestanding.
Oh, well, it's been on a wall for so many years.
It was never meant to be hung. It was for a... It's a ladies' toilet mirror.
Yeah. Is it?
Yeah.
Oh, my goodness me.
Well, let's look at the front and see what we can see there.
Right. Mm-hmm.
I need your help.
All right, sir.
So if we just lift... Incredibly heavy! Oh, the dust of ages in here. Now, if we just tip the frame back... Look, out it comes.
Oh,
wow, what a moment. Now, if I support it, perhaps you could just...
Yeah, okay.
That's great, thank you. Marvellous.
Going down. It's lovely.
And we'll just put it on the easel.
Okay.
So, here's your mirror.
Wow.
What a magnificent thing. What we have here is a toilet mirror dating from about 1660.
Mm. Yeah.
Oh, it's earlier.
Yeah. Yeah.
Sewn by, let us imagine, a young lady of noble birth. This is a grand piece. A supporter of the crown, the monarch, because we have the king, and the queen. This is what we call stump work.
Yeah.
Yes.
And the stump work are the parts where the embroidery is raised up, and it is done by stuffing sheep's wool underneath the embroidery to raise it up off its background. So if we start down here, what you have is a silk ground with the outlines are drawn out, and then the embroiderer would have just started with the background, rather as you do with a painting a picture. And then you do the more complicated bits, the stump work face here, the stitching forms a little pocket, you pull the tiny stitches in, it makes as a pouch, you stuff the face, and then she's has the three-dimensional effect. Wow. Now, what do you think these leaves are?
We guessed at silver, or was it gold?
Leaf that's gone black, is it?
Absolutely right. It's silver thread, which is tarnished to the black.
Yeah.
So can you imagine when this was freshly sewn, the vibrancy?
Yeah. That must have been absolutely terrific.
The silver, the lovely silk at the back. Yeah. Here's more of the velvet along the front. And what about the tortoiseshell frame? It's magnificent, isn't it?
It is.
Tortoiseshell was introduced into England in the mid-17th century through Holland from the Dutch colonies. Tortoiseshell was a very rare and very expensive item. And what they've done here, which you can see through the tortoiseshell here, is the ground of the frame is covered in foil, silver foil, and then the tortoiseshell is set over the foil. So in the candlelight, this would have all scintillated and sparkled. It's a sign of immensely expensive, good quality piece of workmanship. Yeah. Well, where on earth does one start to put a price on it? And I think that collectors, in spite of its condition, would be prepared to pay somewhere between £5,000 and £7,000 for it.
That's absolutely stunning.
It was worth coming back to Wells for a second helping. Glorious objects, and the weather and location weren't bad either. Our thanks to the Bishop for letting us camp out in his wonderful gardens. From the Roadshow, bye-bye.